For those who have not had a chance to meet all of you, my name is Bob Stauffer. I am the National Director of Church Health for the EPC. And welcome. It's great to have you. When you plan for something for so long and it finally gets here, you're kind of surprised that it gets here. But we're so glad to have you here and so glad at the work that the Lord is doing and already doing. Lots of great stuff earlier this morning in here. We had a chance to talk about evangelism and training tools, and I think it was a super helpful time to folks to talk through the issues that we talked through this afternoon during this lunch period. We want to talk for just a few moments about evangelism and kind of the state of evangelism in the United States and maybe around the world. And we are very privileged to have someone who knows a great deal about that topic. Dr. Jimmy Scroggins will be with us today, just so you have the like real biographical information. He's the senior pastor of Family Church, a network of neighborhood churches in South Florida. They are a part of a group of people who have a vision to plant 100 churches in South Florida over the next number of years, and they're already 15 or so in, and doing an amazing work in a very difficult environment. Jimmy is a member of the trustees of Palm Beach Atlantic University and at Lifeway Christian Resources. He teaches as a visiting professor at Southern and Southeastern Baptist Seminaries. He holds a bachelor's degree from Jacksonville University, as well as an MDiv and PhD from the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. Prior to his call to West Palm Beach, he served as the dean of Boyce College, as well as a teaching pastor at Highview Baptist Church in Louisville. He is a highly sought-after speaker around the country and now around the world. Some of you are already becoming familiar with the three circles of which he wrote, and turning everyday conversations into gospel conversations, which he authored. And he is an amazing speaker, but beyond that, an amazing man of God who is living out what he talks about. This is not one of those people who goes around and speaks about something that he isn't doing and passionately involved in. And God has been doing amazing things as we in the EPC have begun to connect with some of the things that they're doing in their ministry network. And also Todd Thomas, Reverend Todd Thomas, will be joining us on stage. He is teaching pastor at one of the, he's the lead pastor at one of the family church networks in Lake Worth, Florida, Sherbrooke, and gifted musician and worship leader, and helps the network in many leadership capacities, and is again doing a lot of speaking around the country as they are sharing what God is doing in their network and the way that many, many people are coming to know Jesus and how that's happening. As I shared with the earlier group, more importantly, he is the husband of my daughter, Sarah. And much more importantly than that, he is the father of three of our grandchildren. So, that's right. They're our grandchildren, so that's the way that works, as you all know. So I'm very excited. We're very excited coming off what we did this morning to kind of follow that up with how do we think about evangelism in our cultural context. And Jimmy's going to challenge us with some thoughts from the Word. We're going to be able to have kind of a panel discussion and ask him questions that are relevant to us in the EPC. So would you welcome with me Dr. Jimmy Scroggins.
Thanks, Bob. I'm good. I got. All right, so Bob always gives us great, fantastic introductions. I'm glad to find out that I'm a sought-after speaker around the world. I did not know that, but I'll see what I can do about it. I'm actually not. I'm a husband and a dad. I'm a pastor. I'm a working pastor of a real-life church where we have staff meetings and funerals and weddings, and we do marriage counseling. And then I have this family of mine. So that's my wife and I. We have six sons and two daughters. And I was talking to Dean, and you know, his family looks like heaven, and my family looks like Alabama. And so, but they'll probably have an Alabama in the new earth also, so there you have it. But, you know, so Chris and I have been married for 28 years. Those are our biological kids. We have no twins. There came one at a time. They are not adopted. They're all homemade, and There you have it. At our church, in Family Church in West Palm Beach, we are a multi-site, multicultural church. We're a multi-generational church by design. We are pleased to call South Florida our mission field. It's where we feel called, and we're thankful to be there. I know some of you are rolling your eyes because you're like, wow, man, called you to a tough place, South Florida. You ought to really think that if you come visit me in February. It is super nice, especially for all the people from Michigan. I can't believe. You know, when you grow up in Florida, I'm a Florida kid, so when you grow up in Florida, Michigan is like Canada. It's like a whole other country. Like, I don't even know where it is. I don't know anything about the geography of Michigan. The only thing I know about the geography of Michigan is there's an airport here that I fly through from time to time. But I am glad to get to be with you guys, and it is a privilege and an honor. And since we are here for just a few minutes, before we talk about specifically about evangelism, I just want to encourage you, if I could, with something from the Bible. And I'm a little always intimidated to do that because pretty much everybody here is a professional level Bible teacher. A lot of you know the word better than I do. Many of you have been teaching the word longer than I have. So I want you to know, as I speak, I'm doing so with a posture of humility towards you, and not presuming that I know more than you about the scriptures. But I would like to just encourage you, if I could, and maybe this will be something. Maybe God'll speak to you and spur you on. Because every single one of us, as we said in the last session, every single one of us is placed in an environment where we are swimming in an ocean of lostness and brokenness. It's all around us. It's in our neighborhoods. It's in our families. And it doesn't matter if you're in a Bible Belt town, or if you're in one of the most unreached portions of the country in the Northwest, or whether you live in a multicultural environment like we do in South Florida. We are all swimming in an environment of brokenness and lostness. We are swimming in an environment where the whole world is confused. The people in this country who are running our universities and colleges and school systems and largest companies can literally, in the last 3 years, they've literally lost the difference to articulate the difference between a boy and a girl. So if you don't think that this world is swimming in confusion and brokenness, I invite you to just turn on CNN and let it roll. The great thing about being a Christian is when you have a book and you have a God, we don't have to be confused about the things that everyone else is confused about, because we know the truth, and we have a design that's given to us from a designer, and it's magnificent. But one of the things that happens, because Christians have a way and have a book, and at least in this country for many years until the last generation or so, Christians still had kind of like cultural hegemony over the culture. We have grown accustomed to be able in some ways to punch down on people who feel differently than we do, whether it's about morality or politics or ethics or whatever. And we have to be really careful with that, because I think what we've done is we've gained a reputation for being the kind of people that push people down and push them out. So the world of lost people expects Christians in churches to just push them further down and push them further out. That's what they think about us. And part of evangelism and part of the task is to reset ourselves to where our posture is not so much push down and push out, as how can we pull in and lift up? And how can we point people to Christ? And I think you see Jesus doing that just over and over and over again. When the religious Pharisees would push people down and push them out, Jesus said, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to pull people in. I'm going to lift them up. I'm going to take a different approach. And I think that's so important. My favorite song, my favorite hymn, one of the verses says, ever since I saw the stream thy flowing wounds supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. And so sometimes it feels like in this world right now, the witness of Christians is crippled. Well, we were talking about... Are you telling me to speed up? Wait. Let's close in prayer. I got the message. At my church, when I go too long, the musicians just come out and start playing. That's their version of get the guy the hook. Let's go. Let's get on with it. It kind of feels like our witness is crippled, because even when we were talking about evangelism in this room, there's a whole different room, and some of you were talking about the intersection of race and Christianity and churches and neighborhoods and politics, and there's a reason why our witness feels like it's crippled. We feel like we're culturally sort of behind the eight ball. We feel like we're having a difficult time moving the conversation forward. And some people may even feel like, because of the political realities, the economic realities, that we're almost getting avalanched and getting marginalized, and our voice is not what it used to be. And then the pandemic hit in 2020. And when the pandemic hit, it even seemed like it just accelerated everything. You guys feel that, don't you? You feel the acceleration of everything. So like the mad people in your church got madder. The people who used to just sort of defer to you, now they tell you off. The people who used to just go along with your sermon, if they didn't agree with something, they just kind of went, oh, well, now they send you an email. That doesn't happen to Presbyterians. Is it just the Baptists? Probably. Plus, I don't like to admit it, but the truth is, I would have told you that this isn't true, but I'll have a little confession with you guys. Is that what I discovered about myself during the pandemic is that I think I really did place a high value on visible results, to where when I would go to church and there were so many fewer people than there used to be, I really did feel like I was doing a worse job, and I was actually doing the same job. The offerings come in. For a while, our offerings went up, 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 even during the pandemic, like a miracle. But this last year, they haven't. Kind of leveled off. Because I think inflation and the crash of the stock market, there's a lot of reasons for that. And it's just put all of us in a tough spot. And then you pile on to that the whole conversation about racial justice. That's very difficult to find how you move that forward within a church family, within a community, within a denomination. Politics, the whole phenomenon of Donald Trump has so polarized so many people. And I'm not really making a comment about who you should or should not vote for. All I'm saying is that phenomena has impacted just about every church in America, and not generally for the better. And then the pandemic, and everybody fighting about, you know, are we going to have church? We're not going to have church. We're going to have mass. We're not going to have mass. If you have mass, you're in fear. If you don't have mass, you hate everybody. You know, it's like, what's going on right now? How many of you would say that your church is still feeling the lingering effects of the pandemic in terms of your church attendance, health, giving, whatever? Would you guys? Okay, we are at Family Church for real in South Florida. Hey, can I just give you some great encouragement for that? If you ever feel like things just aren't the way they used to be, I feel like that. I'm 50 years old. Some of you think you're still young. Some of you think, gosh, you're almost dead. So my kids tell me, you'll probably get to live to 100, Dad. A lot of our family people do. That means you're half dead. I grew up in the 80s. In the 80s, Ronald Reagan was the president. Top Gun, the first one, was made. Karate Kid came out. Rocky IV. The original Red Dawn. Seems like things are a whole lot different. Let me give you a little history lesson from the Bible. I know some of you like are really good Bible historians, and you're going to go, hey, you kind of got the data. Just send me an email. Just go with me on this, all right, guys? 957, Solomon dedicates his temple. Generations of planning have gone into it. The temple's incredible, one of the architectural wonders of the world. He brings the riches of the world into the temple. Leaders from around the world come just to see it. It's made of the finest materials that could be put together in the world. It is an architectural marvel. The Ark of the Covenant is brought in. The day they dedicate the temple, they have this huge, massive procession that goes on and on and on. They have this massive sacrifice. It says in the Bible, over 140,000 animals were sacrificed on that day to the Lord. The Lord is even pleased with it, because as they move the Ark into the temple complex, the Shekinah glory of God comes down from the sky, fills the temple. It fills the temple so thick, the priests have to run out of the temple. The glory of God runs the priests out of the temple. What a day. Can you imagine what it was like to be there and to see the glory of God chase the priests out of the temple? Man. 586, That's a distant memory because the temple gets destroyed. Nebuchadnezzar invades Judah. He besieges Jerusalem. He destroys the temple. He takes all the best stuff out of the temple. He deports all of the best people. And he completely demoralizes God's people. That's his policy. That's how he dominates nations when he overcomes them. He takes their best stuff. He humiliates their religion. He diffuses their best talent and their smartest people and their best people in order to leave just a shell of the country behind. 539, Cyrus and the Persians take over. Cyrus thinks Nebuchadnezzar's policy is dumb. Plus, Cyrus is superstitious. Bad things start happening to Cyrus and in his kingdom, and he immediately thinks, you know what the problem is? We've taken all the stuff from these gods of all these nations. All the gods are mad at us. It's bad juju. We've got to send these people back, let them put their temples back together. It'll calm all the gods down, and we can continue ruling the world in peace. So he sends 50,000 Jewish people back to Jerusalem. He gives them their temple stuff back. He gives them some money to get the project started. And Zerubbabel, as rednecks call it, is in charge of the rebuild. Zerubbabel is a smart leader. He and Nehemiah were both smart. Think about Nehemiah. He came back to rebuild the wall in Jerusalem. What did he do? He said, I'm going to build a wall, and I'm going to get the Persians to pay for it. And so he did. It's in the Bible, guys. In 516, they built this new temple. The new temple gets dedicated. The day they dedicate the new temple, there's no ark. They have just a small, very modest sacrifice, a small and very meager procession. They built the temple with materials that could be scavenged locally. There is no cloud of the Shekinah glory of God recorded on the day they rededicated that temple. You see the first temple? There's the second temple. On social media, we'd say how it started, how it's going. Not good. Some of us may feel like we are stuck right now in the second temple. We may be faced with economic pressure and political pressure and cultural pressure in this country like Christians in this country have never seen. I mean, you just think about it. It's likely we're headed into a recession for the next 3 or 4 or 5 years. That's going to put pressure on everybody and everything. It's going to continue to accelerate some of the anger and some of the political fires that are already kind of smoldering under the surface. And we as Christians, we're going to feel that in our neighborhoods and in our communities and in our cities and in our churches. And that means that even in the United States of America, it's possible that your budget may actually get smaller than it is right now. And some of you are thinking, then it would be zero. Well, the closer you are to zero, the less you have to lose. Buildings may be smaller. You may walk into this church right here, and you may look around and think, I'd like to build a building like that one day. And maybe you will, but probably you won't. There are not many churches that are going to be able to build buildings like this ever again. Maybe a few. Your salary may get smaller. Again, some of you are like, you got to be kidding me. Attendance in our churches might actually get smaller. What are we going to do about that? Well, it's not the first time God's people had to grapple with that. Think about what it said in Haggai chapter 1. In Haggai, the Bible says, in the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Thus says the Lord of hosts, these people say, the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet. Is it a time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses while this house lies in ruins? Now therefore, says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and harvested little. You eat, but you never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages does so to put them in a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the hills, bring wood, build the house, that I may take pleasure in it, and that I may be glorified, says the Lord. Amen. Sometimes you got to do what you can with what you have for the Lord. God said, if you'll go up into the hills and scavenge the materials, I will be pleased. And it'll bring glory to my name. So you do what you can with what you have in the moment that you have. That means we as leaders, we've got to set priorities. And God was telling them, you got to set priorities. You guys are living in paneled houses. God's house is lying in ruins. How about diverting some resources from yourself to the work of glorifying God in the way that you can? They had plenty of excuses. They had no supplies. They had opposition. What we've got to do in our churches is figure out what is God's design. What is God's desire for us right now? And what does he want us to do? And how are we going to think God's thoughts and speak God's words and make God's decisions? We're always going to get more of what we honor, aren't we? As a dad, I've learned that. I get more from my kids of what I honor. I don't get more of what I say I honor. I get more of what I actually honor. And you as church leaders play a fatherly and motherly role in your churches. And as you do that, your church is likely to respond to your leadership by doing more of what you actually honor. If we actually honor evangelism and missional living and church planting, then it's likely our churches will respond with more of it. I feel like I'm in a disco up here, man. I'm like, jamming. This is awesome. Yeah, I said the 80s and now it's back right here on stage. But it is a struggle, and you know, it was a struggle for them to build that second temple. The first six chapters of Ezra are all about this time period. They had to prioritize and commit to it, or they were going to succumb to the pressures in the struggle. And then the preachers, Zechariah and Haggai, had to motivate the leaders and the people to get engaged in the work. That's the job of the preachers. The job of the preachers is to get people to do stuff for God that they weren't going to do before they heard them preach. That's our job. Teach the word of God in a way that compels people to obey God passionately and sacrificially, so that when we're done preaching, God's people are energized to do for God what they weren't going to do for God before they heard the word of God preached. That's why it says Hebrews chapter 10, we're supposed to stir one another up to love and good works. So if you want to jot down a few things, some of you guys are note takers, I just have three thoughts. One, I would just say this. This right now is our time. This is our time. None of us were born during the Protestant Reformation. None of us were called to lead the church to help abolish slavery in the 1800s. Many of us were not in place during the Civil Rights Movement in America in the 1960s. A lot of us were not leading during the heyday of the megachurch movement in the 1980s. But we are here right now in 2022. Just like Zerubbabel and the 50,000 had to go back to rebuild a temple when most of them had never seen the first one in the first place. This is our time. And God wants us to do in our time, in our moment, what we can with the resources that God has given us right now for his glory. Number two, we have to choose to leave the past in the past. That's hard. Church people hate doing that. Have you noticed? Church people literally hate leaving the past in the past. Some of you are like, yeah, I hate it. I know. It's hard to do. That's why even in the recent past, so some of you guys are young and you look down your nose at older people and you think, yeah, these old people won't leave the past in the past. I've heard more guys in their 30s tell me about what their church was doing pre-COVID than anything else in the whole world. How's your church? Well, you know, pre-COVID. That was like 4 years ago, man. We all have a hard time leaving the past in the past. When they built that second temple, there were people alive who could still remember the first temple, and they were not excited about the new one. Haggai chapter 2. Haggai says, who is left among you who saw this house in its former glory? How do you see it now? Is it not as nothing in your eyes? Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord. Work, for I am with you, declares the Lord of hosts. According to the covenant that I made with you when you came out of Egypt, my spirit remains in your midst. Fear not. Think about that. I love how God does that. God runs this thread with these people. Hey, just like I was with the people when they dedicated the first temple, I'm with you when you dedicate the second temple. And not only that, it's an ongoing commitment of God that started a long time ago. He says, just like I brought you out of Egypt, even though there's nobody alive that was brought out of Egypt, he's connecting. All the people of God are connected together. So their promises and their stories are your promises and your stories. He says, I'm with you guys, just like I was with them. Ezra talks about this. Ezra chapter 3. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, all the people shouted. This is so awesome, man. I don't know if you guys know this text or not, but all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. But many of the priests and Levites and heads of fathers' houses, old men who had seen the first house, wept with a loud voice when they saw the foundation of the house being laid. Some of the people that were there were paralyzed because they couldn't leave the past in the past. And when God was doing something new and great in the eyes of a new generation, for the new generation, this is the greatest temple they'd ever seen. But some of the people who could remember the first temple wanted to dampen the joy of this generation because I wanted to talk to them about what had happened in a previous generation. They were paralyzed with the past because they knew that this temple wasn't as great as the other temple. It wasn't as grand. It wasn't as large. It wasn't as ornate. It wasn't as majestic. So no matter what happened, they brought in the sacrifice the best they could. They built the temple the best they could. They had the procession the best they could. They did the best they could. And you can hear the people standing over the side. Well, this isn't like when we did the first temple. Man, have you ever seen a sacrifice like this? Well, yeah, actually, we did 140,000 animals, but you do you, man. It looks great. I'm sure it's great. I don't know who's running it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You can't allow the memories of the past to steal the joy of what is happening right now. God is at work right now. And the people who are meeting God for the first time right now don't really care. This is their time. They are fired up. They are shouting for the Lord. They are praising God. Which group do you want to be in? The God praisers about what God's doing right now, or the old fuddy-duddies complaining about what used to happen a long time ago? Maybe it's just the Baptist. I don't know. Comparison will steal your joy. Compare your church to someone else's church. Your results to someone else's results. And you won't be excited about what God's doing at your place right now because you're always looking over your shoulder at somebody else. We got to be praying. Prayer is our power source. I think we should pray more, but after you pray, you do have to act. Don't use prayer as an excuse for paralysis. Pray and then do. Guilt and regret can paralyze you. Lack of resources can paralyze you. Man, those that were there when Solomon brought in the best, man, the best of the best, the cedars of Lebanon. These young guys building this new temple just went up in the hill and started chopping on whatever tree they had up there. Just go get it and bring it. Got to get everything we can from the hills. And God just wants us to work with what we have right now. We need to quit complaining about what we don't have and quit talking about what we can't do and what we used to do and what somebody else used to do. Why don't we get busy doing gratefully what we can for the Lord in our moment right now with what we have right now? Amen. Last thing. We have to move forward into the future that God has for us. God has a future for us. We're all still alive and Jesus hasn't returned yet. Haggai chapter 2, thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once more in a little while I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all nations so that the treasures of all nations shall come in. And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord of hosts. The latter glory of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts. Man. Around 30 B.C., Herod the Great takes a look at that second temple and he says, this temple stinks. It is no good. I'm going to build a temple better than this one. In fact, I'm going to build one better than Solomon's temple. So Herod the Great, who was not a godly man, expands the temple so that it is way bigger and higher, like 2.5 times bigger than Solomon's temple ever was. And when he did it, people look back at the book of Haggai and said, there it is. That's what Haggai was talking about. Now the glory of this temple, the latter glory, is greater than the former glory. But what happened in 70 AD? The Romans came, destroyed that temple too. So what now? Well, now you, EPC, are the living stones that God is building into a spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priest. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer sacrifices that please God. 1 Peter chapter 2, as you come to him, a living stone rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And yet we do believe that the day is coming when the temple of God will be the new heavens and the new earth. And yet in the meantime, we are to build the kingdom right here, right now, with the resources we have. And we don't need to worry about resources, because just like it was true then, it's true now. God owns all the silver and God owns all the gold. And he can bring as much silver and gold into the work that you are doing right now as you need. That's what Paul says in Philippians. One day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess, because God owns it all. So you don't need to worry about what used to happen. You don't need to worry about what you wish would happen. You just need to get busy about what is happening right now and do what you can with what you have, so that you're not paralyzed by the past or comparing yourself to someone else. We need to do what God is calling us to do right now. Because the day is coming when Jesus will return, and then the latter glory will be better than the former glory. And the whole story of Zerubbabel isn't meant to point us to Zerubbabel as a hero. Zerubbabel is there to point us to Christ as the hero. And I'm not the hero of the story of my church, and you're not supposed to be the hero of the story of your church. Jesus is the story. He's the hero of the story of all the churches. Zerubbabel was a descendant of King David. He's in the genealogy of Jesus himself. And Zerubbabel built a temple, but Jesus is coming, the descendant of David, to build a better temple. In the meantime, what was the purpose of Solomon's temple in the first place? Why did these temples exist? That the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord is God and there is no other. That's what the first temple was for. That's what the second temple was for. That's what Jesus is for. That's what the living stones are for, and that's our task. Pull people in, lift them up, point people to Christ. Do what we can with what we have, and why would we believe that it'll work? Why would this work? It'll work because there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood, they lose all their guilty stains. They lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood. They lose all their guilty stains. That was on time. That was awesome. Hey, before we go into some Q&A and some conversation, let me pray for you guys. It's such an honor to be with you. Father, thank you for the Word of God. Thank you for the people of God. I thank you for the extended family of God that goes around the world to all gospel believers. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ for encouragement and help and resources and focus and faith and sacrifice for the men and women in this room, many of whom labor in a hard place, obscure and unknown, meagerly resourced. Would you help us? And will we do it for your glory, doing what we can with what we have in the name of Jesus Christ? And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
Do these guys, can I be a music minister for a second? Do you guys know that song? All right, ready? We're going to do it. Is that okay? There is a fountain filled with blood from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged
beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood. Lose all their guilty stains.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you, Jimmy, and thank you for the great challenge. This is our time and our opportunity. So we wanted to take the opportunity to have Todd and Jimmy share. Maybe you could share a little bit about what you're doing with Family Church and the context of what you're doing and the power of the neighborhood church, and then we can ask you a couple questions about that.
Yeah, so we're in sunny South Florida, as Jimmy had mentioned, and because it's such a naturally diverse area, instead of First Baptist Church of West Palm Beach just embracing a regional mega church model, we decided to go to the neighborhoods and to do a kind of a parish model type of thing with neighborhood churches. And so that vision really kind of started to take off in 2008, 2009-ish. And now we have 15 neighborhood churches, three languages, English, Spanish, Portuguese. We've got some seed churches spinning up in Creole and in Russian. And we're just trying to figure out how to get more neighborhood churches started that can speak the neighborhood language. You know, if, Lord willing, if we have the resources, a neighborhood building with a neighborhood pastor who speaks the neighborhood language, and doing what we can to push back the darkness of the lostness in our community.
I think one of the things that's interesting for me to watch, the question to which Jimmy was addressing is what are... We feel the pain of coming out of the pandemic and the pain of being in a new culture, but what are some of the opportunities? And I think that's the question really God wants us to ask. And my sense of part of what God is doing is that he's actually calling churches back to their neighborhoods, and that we might have an opportunity for greater evangelism by really engaging with our neighborhoods when we've been largely physically present and spiritually absent. So Jim, could you speak to that a little bit and what that kind of looks like?
Yeah, so I think a couple things. One, I think just culturally, there's a move from the mega to boutique anyways. So there's a reason that they're not building a lot of indoor malls anymore. Did you guys notice that? And the reason is because people are moving away from this idea that everyone's going to drive in and come to one big thing, and they're looking at a more boutique experience. So there's something cultural happening. And a lot of it is around the neighborhood. Have you noticed the rise of the green markets everywhere? Like during the first time of the year, every neighborhood has green markets. Food trucks are another example of this. So there's something cultural happening where people actually would rather be local, they'd rather buy local, they'd rather shop local, they'd rather live local. And that's something important culturally for us to take note of. But besides that, it's missiologically possible. It is possible for a church, even without a big budget or a big facility, or even like, honestly, it's possible for a church without the greatest speaker in the world to be able to have a neighborhood impact, because you can actually build relationships and meet needs and contextualize your ministry to the neighborhood. And that's what we mean by have a neighborhood church in a neighborhood building with a neighborhood pastor that speaks the neighborhood language. It's not necessarily speaking a different language other than English, although that could be part of it. It's speaking the language that speaks to the neighborhood, because every neighborhood is different. And I think that's missiologically part of what we're observing about our culture in a way to think about how we're doing ministry.
And what are some other opportunities that you see culturally that we can take advantage of evangelistically? What are some things we need to be thinking about and leaning into as the church?
I think one thing that we've noticed, and you're probably noticing in your neighborhood churches, is we talked about evangelism a lot this morning and brokenness. I don't know if you sense this, but I think it's a lot easier to have conversations with people. They're a lot more open about the brokenness they've experienced, right? Their frustrations with their marriage or their family or challenges they're dealing with their kids, the same kinds of things that you're dealing with. It seems like people are just a little bit more open to having those discussions. It is a little harder to hide. Even though the pandemic sent us all kind of in hiding, everybody kind of aired their frustrations and their challenges. Not only that, pretty much everybody in your church can identify with somebody dealing with a medical crisis of some kind right now as well, whether it's a COVID issue or something as a result of that. And the discussion right now nationally about mental health and all of that. And so I think one of the unique opportunities is people are just a lot more open about this discussion right now.
And could I add to that too? I think part of that too is we do have clarity on issues surrounding gender and sexuality and family structure that the whole world is giving away. And I do think that we will have the opportunity to welcome refugees from the sexual revolution back into our churches, because there are people who really don't know anything about Jesus, but there are a bunch of dads in your neighborhood that don't want their daughter going into a gym locker room with boys, biological boys. And so they're frustrated with that. So the frustration with that, even though that's not a good thing, the frustration with that opens a door for people who have a plan and have some clarity around these issues. The other thing that I think, to Todd's point, is I think, you know, when I was growing up, we would talk about, for instance, homosexuals. We talk about gay people as if they were a bunch of people out there that we wanted to keep away from us. And so it was not uncommon to come to a church where I would go to, and you'd hear things like Adam and Steve jokes. Because those jokes just aren't funny anymore, because just about every family in our church has family members that are gay or coming out as gay. They have kids that are in college that are transitioning or considering it. So just about every family in our church has these things that we're all wrestling through in our own families and in our own, with our own neighbors and with our own kids' friends. And so it makes all of us so much more empathetic. And empathy and proximity are such powerful tools for evangelism, because all of a sudden I can identify with you. I'm not preaching at you, throwing grenades at you from the safety of my cultural hegemony and my church house. I'm now sharing a confusion with you or a hurt with you or something that I'm walking through. And I think that is so powerful. And I actually think that's a huge open door for Christians to do evangelism.
Let me follow that up real quickly. What would you say to the many churches who are represented here? They're in a neighborhood, maybe not even a neighborhood they're particularly familiar with, but they're in a neighborhood. God has called them there and placed them there. What are some steps they need to be thinking about to really minister well to their neighborhood?
Surprisingly, one of the areas that I think is very open still to encouragement from churches are local schools.
I agree.
I'd be surprised right now. Even as purple of a community as Palm Beach County is, our community immediately surrounding our church, one of our schools has reached out multiple times about, hey, we're dealing with our literacy issues. We're dealing with these kids that have been home, that their parents aren't around. They're having all kinds of mini big brother, big sister type of things and all this. And so I think that's a unique opportunity that we're presented with right now. That's one avenue that we're seeing the community kind of actually reach out in some ways to the church, and you may have experienced that as well.
I just think, again, anything we can do to connect with our community around the family issues. So people need to know how to do marriage successfully. They need to know how to parent successfully. They need to know how to arrange their finances successfully. They need to know how to rebuild after a divorce successfully. I mean, there's all these things that people all have needs for, and no one is offering them answers, because in our culture, to offer answers is almost like the wrong thing to do. But as Christians, we actually have some guidance and we have some clarity around these things that, again, I think as we can offer these, that can really help a lot.
Me? I don't really have anything. I was just sitting over there and there was like three guys in four chairs.
I saw it would look better if there was a fourth guy. My name's Tom Ricks, and I'm National Director of Church Planting for the EPC, and I've had the privilege of meeting these guys very recently and sitting under the teaching that we all heard this morning once again. And I just want to say thank you to both of you for being here. I know your father-in-law is kind of a pain in your neck, and he made you come, but thank you for being here. I mean that sincerely. Everything that you guys have said has been spot on. As I engage with our next generation of church planters around the country, and as we begin to be better at church planting and more active at church planting, we begin to actually draw folks to us that want to plant churches. Everything we've talked about, everything you guys have talked about, the neighborhood approach, the serving approach, the relational approach. Actually, our school shouldn't have to call us. We should be calling them.
That's good.
And volunteering ourselves to them. We should be the ones building the bridges into the relationship. The thing that I'm just starting to see, that I'm curious what you guys think, I could be wrong, is that I feel like we've embraced all of that holistically that we've been talking about, but we seem to be stopping just short of sharing the gospel.
Mm.
And I'm not accusing us of anything. I'm not accusing us, well, we're abandoning scripture. I'm not saying that at all. But it seems like community and service and care and relationship building almost feel like it's in enough of itself. And yes, if the Lord, you know, puts that woman on the airplane down next to me,
right,
a deep sigh of relief, you know, of anguish, and asks me a question, I'll share. But otherwise, maybe not. I haven't led very many people to Christ in sermons in the last couple of years because those people aren't coming to church.
Mm.
I have equipped saints who are going out and living in those communities who are sharing the gospel. So somewhere in all of my pontificating here is a question. and I think that question is, how do you guys envision us keeping the gospel as the central message and the most important thing we do, given all that other support stuff is crucial?
I just think that all of those other things are, I think we do have a holistic picture of the gospel. Because now it's not so the hard part about that is if you make everything the gospel, then nothing's really the gospel, right? So what is the saving gospel? Well, it's the hopeful message of the death of Jesus Christ for our sins and his resurrection and his invitation for everyone to repent and believe. And that's what we've got to get to. So if you don't ever get to that, then you're just Habitat for Humanity with a Bible verse on your t-shirt. And, you know, I'm for Habitat for Humanity, and I've done work with them, but I'm just saying, like, at some point, we do have to get to the gospel. But that's also where I think if we will model that for the people. So all of us have to be soul winners. So that's kind of an outdated term. That's kind of my point. Why is it outdated? He who wins souls is wise. Like, why are we not working harder and focusing more on actually winning men and women, boys and girls to Jesus Christ? And then as we do that, a lot of this is more caught than taught. It's both caught and taught, but you see that modeled with Jesus all the time. You see it modeled with the apostles in the book of Acts all the time. You can read the epistles of St. Paul and read how he's doing this. And so I think at the end of the day, that's why I would encourage you. We've talked about this, and I'm so pleased with the EPC. Choose a tool. Train people on the tool. Use the tool. Have gospel conversations. Talk about gospel conversations in your sermons. Use examples of people in your church. Almost every sermon I preach, I try to include at least one example of someone in our church leading someone to Christ. Now, we have a lot. You say, well, you have a big church. You can do that. That's true. I have a bigger pond to fish from for stories than some other people. But either way, as often as you can, because I think the more we talk about it and the more people see us doing it and the more people are around us when we do it, the more they're going to want to do it too. I don't see another way. I wish I had a silver bullet for that. There's not a silver bullet besides open your mouth and share the gospel. I mean, that's the method. And it's a foolish method, St. Paul said. Right? It's a foolish method and it's a foolish message. And we're a bunch of foolish messengers. Right? But that's what God uses to save people's souls.
One of the things we talked about this morning, if you weren't in the room, we talked about bottleneck conversations and finding pathways in the life of your church, the rhythm of your church, where these conversations can happen normally and regularly. One of the things that we have done with our schools is our back-to-school Sunday approach that we
have. That's great, Todd.
We invite the teachers and the principals of those schools to come, and we tell them in advance, hey, we're going to have a little present for you for your school. We got a little gift to help you with some things that you're going to do this year. But we want to pray for you. We know you guys deal with a lot. You may not be a Christian. That may not be like something that's normal for you. But would you just come one time and let our church see who you are, because we think you're heroes in our community? It will not be uncommon if the three circles are drawn on a board on that Sunday.
Yeah.
So I just want you to know, like, we are, now that's one way. They're coming to our turf. They understand who we are. They know we're going to be us, but it's an opportunity for them to also see, like, hey, these people talk about that. They're also praying for us. They gave us a gift. They're trying to figure out how to invest in our school. The other thing I would say is, if you got that relationship with that principal or that educator or that organization, it's an old phrase that Andy Stanley uses a lot: build bridges of trust that can sustain the weight of truth. So, like, if you built a good bridge there, then at some point, like, you got to be faithful to say, hey, I'd love to buy you a cup of coffee, and I just want to tell you something that's really helped me deal with some of the really difficult things in life. And, you know, I'll share it with you once. You never have to hear it again, but I'd love to sit. And I think if your people see you modeling those kinds of conversations, I just think that will, you get what you honor. Mm-hmm. And if you start honoring that and you start living that out, I think you're going to see more of your average Joe Christian in your church trying with their neighbor and figuring out how to get the gospel to them.
Yeah, really good, Tom.
Can I do a follow-up? I wasn't sure what the rules were. So, typical church planter. I'll show up.
You're asking me about rules?
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a really good point. You said, Jimmy alluded to it, and you just said it, Todd. We have to set the example.
Yeah.
If you say to me, Tom, tell me the last time you shared the gospel with somebody, and I either A, can't think of it, or B, it was more than like a week and a half ago, there's something wrong.
Yeah.
And I think that as pastors and church planters are pastoral, right? As pastors, we tend to think we are equipping the saints for the works of the service, but we forget that we are called to be on the front lines, that we are called, you know, Jesus didn't send out the 72 until he was well into his ministry, where he had been every day saying to people, repent and believe because the kingdom of God is at hand. So I just want us to be I don't ever want us to be a top-down leadership denomination, but I certainly want us to be a denomination where our leadership is, and I agree, I love the three circles, by the way. I put it in the very last sermon I ever preached to my church. I put it up on the board and said, this, you know, if you don't pick anything else, pick this, right? But whatever it is, as leaders, we have to be following Jesus by actively sharing him with others, with service, with care, with relationship, all that, but verbalizing the gospel of Jesus, putting that all together. And I agree with you. When our people hear, you know, our stories, and sometimes they're goofy. I started driving Uber because I realized I wasn't around any non-Christians. I had all Christian friends. I'm like, I'm going to start driving Uber, and I got to share the gospel. I can't tell you how many people I got to share the gospel with, right? And it wasn't because I said, hey, now that you're in my Uber car, I'm going to tell you about Jesus.
I ain't never heard of that before.
They just started asking questions.
Could you guys imagine getting in Tom's Uber?
Oh, my gosh, it's unbelievable. It's like, so are you retired? No, I'm not retired. I know, like, I'm not retired. What do you do? I'm a pastor of a church. You may not have any faith. Or whatever, you know, and it'd be like, could you pray for me?
Yeah,
or,
yeah.
You know, it's, so again, I just feel like as leaders, if we're not telling people about Jesus, it's kind of hard to preach that sermon where we encourage our folks to do that. So, again, I want to thank you guys for emphasizing that. Please follow up comment.
No, my one follow-up comment is I just kind of want to applaud what you're doing this year at General Assembly. The whole theme of recharge and keeping the E of the EPC as at the forefront there is something distinct about that in the EPC. Yep. And, like, as the outside Baptist looking in, like, there is a difference, right? Like, we've all seen the direction that a lack of missional clarity and theological clarity took the PCUSA. All right, this is being filmed. I'm going to just be charitable for a minute. So we've all seen this in a variety of denominations. We've also seen a variety of denominations that they might have had some theological clarity, but their orthodoxy didn't lead to orthopraxy. So, like, there's a problem there, right? So, like, there's dying denominations. And what I appreciate about what the EPC is trying to do this year and from here forward is just reignite the flame of personal evangelism and personal ownership to get the gospel to not just to the ends of the earth, but to our neighbors and to the people in our community. So the fact that there's coordinators and there's coaches and the presbyteries are training, like me and a couple guys got to go and do one of those presbytery trainings with the Allegheny folks, go Steelers, you know? And so like, we've gotten to see it, and I know that there's so much more to come in the next couple months to see this happen. So I just want to encourage you, just like one from the outsiders looking in and catching a glimpse, I would lean into all of it. Whatever struggle you might have in your spirit about, like, oh, we're kind of doing our own thing, we kind of got a good thing going already, I would lean into all of it. And if you're a church that's equipped and you're doing well, figure out how to big brother some of the other churches in your presbytery and help pull them along and instill some evangelistic zeal there. I would just lean into all of it with your coaches, with your coordinators, with your presbyteries, and link arms together, man. Listen, life's too short. Great Commission's far too important. So link arms and go do it. So I just want to applaud that to you.
Amen.
Guys.
Me too.
Amen. And just to that point, for all of you who are gathered here, church and presbytery and denominational leaders, really want to encourage you to find your church planters and to find your church coordinators and your coaches and pray for them and encourage them and support them, because it's not always easy. Some of y'all are crazy. So they face lots of challenges. But I think the thing we're trying to instill, at least at this level, is that leaders who are not evangelistic and missional cannot lead evangelistic and missional churches. So we can say it's somebody else's fault all day long, but we need to look in the mirror first, beginning with me, and say we need to own this, and we need to lean into it, and we need to do the things, as Jimmy said in his talk. You know, we're here now, and God has brought us here now, and this is our time and our season, so let's lean into it for God's glory. So please find your coordinators, coaches, and church planners. Give them encouragement, write them a note, support them however you can. That's how the movement will move forward. So another quick question. We've looked at some of the opportunities that may be available to us by reaching out to our neighborhood. What are some of the big obstacles that we might need to be aware of culturally and sensitive to culturally as we try to create an evangelistic culture?
I mean, I don't know that those obstacles have changed all that much. I mean, I just think there's a, you know, sin nature bends away from the gospel. And so when you have people that are not believers in Jesus, they have a natural resistance to the gospel. And so it's going to, the culture can shift and change, but that resistance is always the same. And I also think just the hot button issues of the day that are going to always make you seem like you're out to lunch. So the exclusivity of the gospel, the exclusive claims of Jesus as the means of our salvation is going to be a problem for a lot of people. The reality of hell and judgment is going to be a big problem for a lot of people. I think those two things are particularly difficult. And the crazy thing about it is we actually believe in a lot weirder stuff than that, but those are the sticking points. I mean, think about the stuff you believe. It's weird, man. You can't even explain it to somebody who's not into it because it just makes no sense. I mean, you try to preach through the book of Revelation while you're trying to be sensitive to, like, non-Christians who might be in the audience. It's weird. But I still think that brokenness hurts so bad. And I think brokenness is so painful. And I think, you know, at the end of the book of Revelation, when Jesus says, "Come to me," you know, the bride and the bridegroom say, "Come." And the Lamb says, "Come. If you're thirsty, come and drink from the fountain of water without price." You don't have to pay anything. It's already been paid. There is this idea that underneath all of the anger and the brokenness and the strife and everything, there is a deep sense of yearning for some living water. And if we can find the people where the Spirit is moving, Even our strange and mysterious gospel will make sense. That's how you got saved. Somehow this whole thing made sense to you. And I don't know about you, but like, I have an education. I think I'm a relatively critical thinker, but like, I do not struggle with the Christian faith. I'm not trying to figure out if I'm really going to believe this or not. I believe it. For some reason, at this point, it's just easy for me to believe. And when God squeezes somebody's heart, so to me, that's the biggest obstacle, is where is God working and how can we so broadly, and then how can we ask the Spirit of God to help us find the fields where he's working so that we can work the fields in the appropriate season and harvest in the appropriate season.
I appreciate the fact that when we talked about creating an evangelistic culture in our churches, you start with prayer.
Yeah.
And I think the reality of the spiritual attack and the attack of the enemy, I think as we denominationally begin to get serious about this, we better be equally serious about how we're praying together. Because it's God who's going to rescue us and save us and keep us from those attacks.
Amen.
One last question I have, Tom, you?
I'm good.
So, ask it this way. Your Reformed Southern Baptist, which we all call Oh So Close. So you're
come to the dark side.
Many have.
Now I've forgot the question. So you are able to look, you've kind of been to our offices and seen what we're doing, kind of look at us with those fresh outside eyes. What would you do to encourage us or challenge us in the area of becoming an evangelistic denomination? What does that look like? How do we process that? How do we think about that?
I just think you're already on a track right now where you have the right people in these conversations. We've got 180 to 200 people in that morning thing. We're talking about evangelism and 300 people in the room right now. And I would say we already talked about leaning into the process and the things that are happening, but like, you have to take, everybody in this room has to take this conversation to your lay people. You got to figure out who your key people are in your church, have them over for dinner, talk to them about having gospel conversations, talk to them about creating a greater evangelistic zeal in your church, pull your staff close, figure out how you can invest in them and help them to live this out. I just think those are going to be some of the simplest ways. I mean, I would just, I would encourage you to do that. I would, the way we talk about it is spilling a lot of Cracker Barrel syrup, right? You got to get with people. Meals help you do that. Sitting down with somebody, sitting down with your leaders, and just helping them realize, hey, we've been painting a picture as a denomination about where we could go and the importance of the Great Commission and a kingdom mindset. I want to bring you in on the conversation, and I want you to help us figure out how we're going to do this as a local congregation and how we partner with our presbytery, things like that. Now, my previous life before joining Family Church, we planted a church in Lexington, Kentucky. So we were there for 15 years. And a lot of the, is every presbytery right now have some new work going? Church planting, or pretty close?
Pretty close.
All right, so like, let me just tell you on being on the other side of that, being the one that was the planter, I would just, if you hear about church planters in your presbytery who are going through the process and doing the hard work of trying to spin up a new work, send your SEAL Team 6 best Christians to go help them. Do what you can. Like, I know you're thinking, oh, what will happen to my congregation if I send up my best? You'll figure it out. You'll raise up a new best, but that church planter needs your best. If we're going to keep doing some good gospel work and plant some new churches, you've got to be willing to be open-handed. That's your best resource you have to help that church planter. Send your best.
Can I take it one step further? The church I pastor, Green Tree Community Church, every time we planted a church, and we planted several over a couple decades, we got stronger. Because God is not a God of scarcity. God is a God of abundance. The scarcity is my faith.
Yeah.
And if I'm too afraid, you know, like send my SEAL Team 6, then my faith is in the wrong place. So just keep preaching what you're preaching.
I'm just so encouraged. So one of the reasons why I would be here today is because I'm so encouraged by the people that you have selected as your leadership. So if you look at Dean, or Bob or Tom, you look at who's leading the charge on these things. And I just say, any group that's going to choose those men and say, hey, you guys carry the flag, you guys train us, you guys support us, you guys network with us, well done. And but I just don't have any critiques, because I'm so encouraged, like, by just the spirit of the group every time I'm around you guys. And just being in this room today, and we've been here like all day, and some of you are like, I know, when are you going to start? But I'm just so encouraged and impressed by the spirit of Jesus that permeates the room. So I think if we just lean into that, listen to the leaders that you've chosen, that God's brought, boy, this group really can change the world. You really can change the world. You really can. And that's the dream, isn't it? It's the whole world.
So I'm going to close this in prayer, and I'm going to ask you all to stand for two reasons. One is because if you don't, the blood's going to stop flowing. Secondly, when you stand up, the pastor realizes they can't pray too much longer. Let's pray. Father God, all of this is from you. We just heard a few moments ago from the books of the Old Testament, going back to Solomon's day. Father, you are the God of the covenant, and your plan will not fail. It will not be thwarted. What could be lost is our opportunity to be in your presence as you're doing these things. So, Father, we know that if we don't do it, you'll raise somebody else up that will. Jesus said, I can use rocks. And so, Father, help us to be a people of faith who trust you and share the name of Jesus. Father, help us to be, even in our fears, even in our concerns, and everything that was mentioned earlier by Jimmy, all those things are true. Post-pandemic, pre-pandemic, fear, all the stuff going on social media, all the confusion, Lord, all those obstacles are there, but they're not obstacles to you. And so, Lord, help us to, as has already been said so eloquently, see this as the day that you have given to us to serve your kingdom, to be used by you to grow your kingdom. So use us, Father. We pray for Jimmy and Todd that you would bless their ministries, bless their work, bless what they've said and taught to us today, and use it, Lord, in us and through us, that your kingdom may grow and that the name of Jesus would be glorified. We pray in his name, and all God's people said, amen.